You can, for the moment.
Yeah, that'll be fine. It may be easier, Peggy, for you to just, you sit in my chair. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this evening's Askwith, the title of which is Teens and Sex. We're thrilled that you're here, and I'd like to take just a moment to introduce you to the wonderful panel that has been assembled. The first person I'd like to introduce, and you'll get to meet her in just a minute, is Peggy Orenstein, who is a graduate of Oberlin College and is the author of the New York Times bestsellers, Girls and Sex, Cinderella Ate My Daughter, and Waiting for Daisy, as well as Flux, Women on Sex, Work, Kids, Love, and Life in a Half-Changed World, and the classic Schoolgirls, Young Women, Self-Esteem, and the Confidence Gap. Peggy is a contributing writer for the New York Times Magazine, and has also written for such publications as the Los Angeles Times, Vogue, Elle, Time, Mother Jones, Slate, O, the Oprah Magazine, and The New Yorker, that's a wide variety, and has contributed commentaries to NPR's All Things Considered, which is where I heard her, and the PBS NewsHour. She has been a keynote speaker at numerous colleges and conferences, and has been featured on, among other programs, Nightline, CBS This Morning, The Today Show, NPR, Fresh Air, and Morning Edition, and CBS's As It Happens. In 2012, the Columbia Journalism Review named Peggy one of its, quote, 40 women who changed the media business in the past 40 years. She has been recognized for her outstanding coverage of family diversity by the Council on Contemporary Families and received a Books for a Better Life Award for Waiting for Daisy. Among other honors that she has received is one she prizes from Planned Parenthood Federation of America. Our next presenter is Justine Fonte. Justine founded the health and wellness program at the Dalton School in Manhattan 4 years ago and serves as its director. She is a consultant on social justice and health education programming for independent schools in the Northeast. She also serves on the board of directors of Roots of Health, a nonprofit that provides free clinical and educational reproductive services to women and girls in the Philippines. She's very proud of that work. Justine evaluated the adolescent reproductive health programs for the Department of Education in the Philippines. And to show the range of her creativity and her work, she also produced and performed in Raised Panay, an original community-created play showcasing the narratives of 13 Filipino women in the United States that premiered in New York City last month at the Philippine Consulate with $14,000 in ticket sales benefiting Roots of Health. Well done. Fonte received her master's in education from the University of Hawaii and a master's in public health from Columbia University. And the third person on our panel is someone whom we know very well here at the Ed School, admire and love, and that is Senior Lecturer Rick Weissbourd, who is the Faculty Director of the Human Development and Psychology Master's Program. His work focuses on vulnerability and resilience in childhood, the achievement gap, moral development, and effective schools and services for children. With Stephanie Jones, he directs the Making Caring Common Project, a national effort to make moral and social development priorities in child raising and to provide strategies to schools and parents for promoting in children caring, a commitment to justice, and other key moral and social capacities. One more thing, and he didn't want me to talk about him very long. For several years, he has worked as a psychologist in community mental health centers, as well as on the Annie Casey Foundation's New Futures Project, an effort to prevent children from dropping out of school. We know that he has done much more, but would you give a round to the three of them? I would also like to acknowledge members of the task force that was instrumental in pushing for this Askwith and also for ensuring that it happened this evening. Would you all stand that we might recognize you? Thank you. So without further ado, I'm going to ask Peggy to come to the fore, and she will be talking with us for about 25 to 30 minutes, and then we'll join her on the stage for some questions and conversations that I have, and then I'll open it up for the last 25 minutes to you in the audience, and at that time I'll ask you to cue up to the mic. It's really seductive when you talk to the mic. People become really in love with hearing their voices. But I ask you now, when you come up to the mic, please come up with a question. A short and pointed question. Thank you so much. Without further ado, Peggy Orenstein.
I gotta tell you that wherever I go, somebody always, this is like a universal issue. Yes, please come up to the mic and ask an actual question. I don't know. I don't mind. Anyway, I wanted to talk a little bit about how I came to write Girls and Sex and some of the things that I found during my reporting. And I wanted to start by saying, you know, it really was an outgrowth of my previous work. I've been writing about girls for over 20 years now. And my last book was called Cinderella Ate My Daughter, and that looked at the ways that the pink and pretty, sparkly culture of girlhood started to train girls into this idea that how they looked was more important than who they were. And so it felt kind of natural to move on to that, to looking at older girls who were wrestling with the idea of hot, which tells them that how their bodies look to other people, again, are more important than how those bodies feel to themselves. Meanwhile, I am a mom myself, and I have a daughter who is in middle school. And I was hearing a lot of stories from my friends with older kids about the hookup culture and about sexting and about binge drinking. And, you know, my response as the parent of a little girl was to just say, I don't want to hear it. Don't tell me about it. Because parenting from ignorance and fear is always a great strategy, I find. Yeah, so that, you know, sort of made me take another look. And then the final thing was that we were having this umbrella conversation in the culture about sexual assault and consent on campuses. And that is such an important conversation, such an important conversation to be having. And I also thought, consent is a really low bar for a sexual experience. You know, like, I was not assaulted, really low bar for a sexual experience. So it became really important to me to think, you know, this should not be the end point of the conversation. It should be the beginning. And what we really need to be doing is talking about what is going on with kids after yes. So I began to, you know, and I wanted to know whether the young women of this generation, did they have more freedom than my generation? Were they more able to shape their sexual encounters? Did they have more influence and more control within those encounters? Were they better able to resist stigma? Were they better able to explore joy? So I began going around the country interviewing girls, and in all I did about 70 in-depth interviews of girls between the ages of 15 to 20. And I chose girls, they were a pretty broad ethnic spectrum, but they were mostly college-bound, or they were all college-bound or in college, and mostly middle class. And I chose that group intentionally because I wanted to look at girls who thought of themselves as having all opportunity, who considered themselves to be the beneficiaries of the feminist movement. Because if even those girls who were, you know, had made so much progress in education, had such ambitions professionally, you know, who were just like leaning in all over the place, if even those girls were toppling in their personal lives, then you couldn't deny that there was a problem. So one of the things that became clear to me was that this generation of young women felt entitled to engage in sexual behavior, but they didn't necessarily feel entitled to enjoy it. So one of the young women that I talked to said to me, I come from generations of strong women. My grandma was a firecracker. My mother is strong. My sister and I are loud, and that's our form of feminine power. And then she proceeded to narrate to me a kind of series of not very satisfying, not particularly reciprocal, one-off hookups that were the sort of sum of her sexual experience. And she said, you know, I guess we girls were just so socialized to be these docile creatures who don't express what we want. And I said, but 5 minutes ago, you just told me what a strong woman you are. And she hemmed and hawed and said, yeah, you know, I guess nobody told me that that smart, strong woman image also applied to sex. So again, I think part of what goes on here is that there's this disconnect between the sexiness that the culture demands from young women and the lack of honest, frank conversation about sexuality. And earlier I mentioned hot, and again, the, you know, with the idea of hot being that how your body looks to other people is more important than how that body feels to yourself. And whereas I think Gen X moms or baby boomer moms would have pushed back against that idea as being about self-objectification, for today's young women, it's much more complicated because it's sold to them as an idea of personal power and confidence, and sometimes the main form of personal power and confidence. So one young woman that I spoke to showed me a picture of herself in a miniskirt and a crop top and skyscraper heels going to a party, and she said, I'm proud of my body, and I never feel more liberated than when I'm wearing skimpy clothes. And then about 5 minutes after that, she told me that she wouldn't have worn that outfit a year earlier because she was 25 pounds heavier. And as she said, some jerky guy might have called me the fat girl, and that wouldn't have been good for my mental health. So, you know, it's understandable that you'd feel good about showing off the right body and affirming to attract male attention and even female envy. But what I think we need to talk to young women about is who gets to be proud of which body and under what circumstances, and how liberating that can be when humiliation lurks just around the corner. And the thing is that we push girls to be sexy, but then when they comply, we demonize them. We tell them that they're dressing like hookers, we tell them that they're distracting boys, rather than engaging them with them in discussion and critique and talking about what the culture wants from them and the impact of self-objectification on young women. Because we know that self-objectification negatively affects cognition, girls' sense of political efficacy, the idea that they can be effective in creating change. It's linked to body monitoring, depression, eating disorders, and in a real bait and switch, it's linked to reduced sexual satisfaction. And yet, the performance of sexiness has not just been conflated with sexuality, it has often replaced it. The culture is littered with female body parts, and yet again, we don't have a substantive conversation with young women about developing their own sense of their own sexuality from within. And because of that, the confidence often comes off with the clothes. Because really, who cares how your body looks if you don't understand its responses? And the way that I put this is in a framework of what Sarah McClelland, who's a psychologist at University of Michigan, calls intimate justice. And what that is, you know, just like we know that who washes the dishes in your home or who vacuums the rug is in part a political issue, sex brings up those same dynamics. Dynamics that involve equity, dynamics that involve personal power, mental health, violence. And intimate justice begs us to ask the questions, who has a right to engage in a sexual experience? Who has a right to enjoy it? Who's the primary beneficiary of that experience? And how does each partner define good enough? And honestly, those questions are really tricky for adult women, and sometimes really traumatic for adult women. But when we're talking about girls and their early sexual experiences, the thing that I kept coming back to over and over was that I didn't want girls' early experiences to be something that they had to get over. So one thing that became clear to me as I was doing my reporting was that we define sex way too narrowly when we talk to young people. Both in sex education and when we talk to kids as parents, we tend to focus exclusively on intercourse. And that allows the other things they're doing to be marginalized and ignored, and opens up the door to disrespect and risk. That's particularly true of oral sex, which teenagers consider less intimate than intercourse, at least if boys are on the receiving end. The young women that I met had a lot of reasons for participating. It made them feel desired, it boosted social status, it helped them avoid the emotional intimacy they feared would happen with intercourse, what they called catching feelings, as if it was a disease. And sometimes it was because young men, they were trying to get out of an uncomfortable situation. One freshman in college said, sometimes you do it at the end of the night because you don't want to sleep with a guy and he expects to be satisfied. After hearing a lot of stories about non-reciprocal oral sex, I began to ask girls, hey, visual aid, what if every time you were with a guy, he asked you to go to the kitchen and get him a glass of water? And he never asked you to get him, or he never got you a glass of water. Or if he did, it was like, you want me to, you know, like really begrudging. You know, you would never stand for that. And they would laugh and say, well, when you put it that way. And I would say, you know, well, why wouldn't you put it that way? But it wasn't just that boys weren't interested. It was also that girls were uncomfortable with the idea of oral sex. They had learned shame around their genitals, and they described them as both icky and sacred. So one of the issues that kept coming up when I talked to girls was the idea of removing all their pubic hair, which most of them did and had been doing since they were 14. And when we would first start talking about that, they would say they did it for themselves, they did it because they thought it was cleaner. But after a while, it would come out that they also did it because they were afraid of humiliation, because they'd heard some guy say that if he were hooking up with a girl and there was hair down there, he'd walk out the door, or because some boys in school were saying, you know, saw a little line of pubic hair or something and said, ooh, that's disgusting, that girl's horrible. And when I thought about the rise in pubic hair removal, which is a real generational divide, I thought about how in the 1920s we started, women started shaving their armpits and legs consistently, and that was because flapper fashions came in, and for the first time women's limbs, their arms and their legs, were publicly visible and open to public scrutiny. And so there's a way that I think this too is a sign that the most intimate realms of our body are now open again to public scrutiny and to critique. And again, that's more about how they look than how they feel to us. And I don't know if you, did you all see that article in the New York Times the other day about labiaplasty? This like made me really just nuts. So the first time that I wrote about labiaplasty in this book, I had to actually look up what the word meant because I had never heard of it. And it's the trimming of the outer or inner vaginal lips to create a more aesthetically pleasing experience. And the most sought after look is, wait for it, the Barbie, which is a clamshell fused appearance because Barbie's made of plastic and has no genitalia. And the rates of labiaplasty, there was an article in the Times a couple days ago, last week, that said that the rates of labiaplasty among young girls have gone up 80% since 2014. And again, you know, it's a small number, but whereas girls are 2% of all plastic surgery, they're 5% of labiaplasty. And I think those girls, again, small number, but I think they're kind of canaries in the coal mine that are telling us something about how girls are feeling about their bodies and what we need to address. And it's pretty clear, and their anxiety about how they look, it's pretty clear that these trends are coming directly from porn. And for in terms of porn, the internet has just been a total game changer in terms of kids and sex. And there was a survey from England that looked at college students in the UK and found that 60% of respondents said that they consulted porn in part as sex education. And again, you know, if you're not getting it from your parents, if you're not getting it from schools, there it is online. And again, you know, not so much where you want your kid learning about sex. You know, a realm where women, sexuality, again, performance for men, where bodies are distorted, where humiliation is eroticized. And kids are being exposed to porn at ever younger ages now because of the internet, and the porn they're being exposed to is more explicit. And that's coming into the bedroom in ways that are questionable for both boys and girls. But what girls would say to me, I'll put this on the more G-rated end of the spectrum, and if you want to talk about the other end, we can do that too, but they would say to me often, my boyfriend wants to know why I don't make the noises that girls in porn make when we have sex. And they would ask me that as a question, and I would, my journalistic, you know, distance that I'm supposed to have would crumble, and I would say, look, it's a movie, and movies need a soundtrack. Otherwise, they're silent movies. So if they didn't make those noises, it would be a silent movie, and that would be weird. So, you know, that's why they do that. And there was like a, this light bulb would go off. And, you know, the importance of talking to kids, getting out front on porn and talking to them about the ways that it's unrealistic, about the ways that it distorts the bodies, that it is, you know, about as realistic as pro wrestling. And again, you know, and no surprise too, and I think, in talking about, you know, the noises and all of that, a longitudinal study of college students in Maine found that rates of faking orgasm among girls have been rising steadily since the 1990s. And again, going back to that idea of intimate justice, who gets to enjoy, who's the beneficiary, how does each partner define good enough? When we talk about sexual satisfaction, we think that we're talking about one thing, but sexual satisfaction is a gendered idea. And young women are more likely to talk about, to measure their sexual satisfaction by the yardstick of their partner's pleasure. So they're more likely to say in a heterosexual relationship, if he's satisfied, then I'm satisfied. Young men are more likely than young women to measure their satisfaction by their own pleasure. So they're more likely to say, if I had a good time, I'm satisfied. Conversely, with bad sex, young women use language like degradation, humiliation, depression, pain. Young men never use that language in the research. Young women report pain in 30% of young women report pain in their last encounter if it involved vaginal sex, 70% if it involved anal sex. So when young women report sexual satisfaction levels equal to or greater than young men's, which they often do in the research, it's a little deceptive. Because if a girl is going into an encounter hoping that it won't hurt, wanting to feel close to her partner, and expecting that he'll have an orgasm, then she's going to be satisfied if those criteria are met. And there's nothing wrong, of course, with wanting to feel close to your partner or wanting him to be happy, and orgasm is not the only measure of sexual fulfillment. Still, absence of pain, again, a pretty low bar for your own sexual fulfillment. And when I think of all of that, I think part of the reason is that we perform what I call a psychological clitoridectomy on American girls. And it completely silences ideas of female pleasure and sexuality. So when we have our children, when we have infant boys, we're more likely to name all the boys' body parts. At least we'll say, here's your pee-pee, we'll say something. But with girls, we go right from navel to knees, and we leave this whole situation in here unnamed. And there's really no way to make something unspeakable better than to leave it unspoken, leave it unnamed. Then they go into their puberty education class, and they learn that boys have erections and ejaculations, and girls have unwanted pregnancy and periods. Other way around, periods and unwanted pregnancy. Then they see that internal diagram of, you know, of women's, the thing that looks like a steer head, and it grays out between the legs. So we never say vulva. We never say clitoris. Not surprisingly, fewer than 50% of girls ages 14 to 17 have ever masturbated, though they do go down there to shave off their pubic hair. And then we expect them to go into their sexual encounters and have a voice, to think, for either boys or girls, to think that sex is about girls, to feel that they have an entitlement to speak, to express their wants, needs, desires, limits. It's not really very realistic. One thing that's interesting, though, is that that idea that a partner's pleasure is primary holds true even when girls are in same-sex encounters. So in same-sex encounters, bisexual and lesbian girls have orgasm rates at the same rate as boys in heterosexual encounters. And what girls would say to me, bisexual and lesbian girls, was that it was liberating for them to get off the script. And they use that word, script, of the media and the cultural idea of heteronormativity, obviously. And that when they did that, they were free to create an experience that worked for them and that was satisfying for them. And that was something that I think all of us could learn from. The other thing that talking to gay girls challenged for me was the idea of virginity as defined by first intercourse. And I'm not saying by saying that that first intercourse isn't a big deal. Of course it's a big deal. But it's worth questioning how our emphasis on first intercourse is, why that act, we think that that act, and we tell kids that that act, is going to be so much more transformative for them than anything else, why that's the line between innocence and experience, and whether that's serving girls, whether it's keeping them safer from disease, coercion, betrayal, assault, whether it's giving them more control in their sexual experience, whether it encourages mutuality and caring, how it affects the perception of other kinds of sexual interactions, and what it means for gay teens who can have multiple sex partners without heterosexual intercourse. So one of the gay girls I talked to, I asked her how she knew she wasn't a virgin anymore. And she said, yeah, I wondered about that, so I Googled it. Google didn't know. So I said, well, so how did you decide? And she said, well, you know, I thought about it, and she went through all these things. She said, you know what I think it was? I think it was the first time I had an orgasm with a partner. That was when I wasn't a virgin anymore. And I just thought, whoa, you know, what if, just for a second, we defined virginity as that? How that would shift the whole way we approach sexuality. And, you know, again, not because intercourse is not a big deal, but it's not the only big deal. And rather than conceiving of sex as a race to a goal, that helps us think of sexuality as a pool of experiences that involve affection, warmth, closeness, desire, touch, arousal, intimacy, all these different things, and not this kind of voom, trying to get someplace. Because, you know, it's worth talking to young people about who is really the more sexually experienced person. Somebody who has kissed a partner for 3 hours and experimented with erotic tension and sensuality and communication, or somebody who got wasted at a party and hooked up with a random to get rid of their virginity before they went to college. So, speaking of hooking up, we talk about the hookup culture and we talk about rape culture on campus, and both of those are, to my mind, outgrowths of these issues. In terms of hooking up, I think the first thing you have to do is, you know, what is hooking up? You always have to say, what is hooking up? Hooking up can be anything, and it's an intentionally ambiguous term. It might mean kissing, it might mean oral sex, it might mean vaginal sex, it could mean anything. And because of that, kids tend to overestimate what other people are doing because it's an ambiguous term. Hookup culture, however, is, I mean, kids didn't invent casual sex. Please, you know what I'm talking about. However, what has changed is the idea that that it's been normalized that sex ought to proceed rather than arise out of intimacy. And although hooking up is not by any means all that kids are doing on campus, that becomes the normalized idea. And you have to, especially at some of the schools that I went to, define your sexuality, whether you opt in or opt out of that culture, in relationship to that culture. And some of the girls that I talked to wanted to come to talk to me because they wanted to tell me that they liked hookups. They were not victims of hookup culture, they were participants of hookup culture. It was, and they had, you know, they were busy, they wanted to focus on their studies, they wanted to hang out with their friends, they wanted to do their internships, they wanted to do whatever they were doing. They didn't want to have a boyfriend, they didn't want to take care of somebody, but they wanted to have an active sex life. And it was an interesting shift because, especially here at Harvard, you know, for many years we've talked about girls developing in relationship too. And, you know, the women's way of knowing, or Carol Gilligan, or all those kinds of things. And this is girls saying, no, I want to develop independent from. So it's just sort of an interesting shift in the way that they're thinking. And either way, it's not about valuing interdependence. And my job in writing about hookup culture was not to tell young women or young men in what context they ought to be sexual, but to help them understand what that was like for people, you know, for real, and also what they were likely to get or not get out of those sexual experiences. So when you're talking about a hookup, girls were likely to get an adrenaline rush, a warm body, a war story, a feeling of conquest, a feeling of being wanted, a feeling of being desirable. What they were less likely to get was good sex, or the tools that they needed in order to have good sex or create intimacy. So rather than the glamorized view that the media was giving of hookups, to have that central information and make your choices accordingly. So much of these ideas and arguments feed into the discussion of rape on campus. And I didn't want my book to be taken over by that discussion. It was really a difficult struggle for me. Because I felt when I was going around with my previous book and I would talk a little bit about sexuality and the differences between sexuality and sexualization and healthy sexuality, that parents that I talked to would nod, and then immediately go back to victimization of girls. And I realized that in this a weird thing to say, but it felt like people were more comfortable talking about girls as victims than as girls as agents of their sexuality. And so I didn't want to veer too far into that terrain, but I did want to give context about the history of the movement on campuses to combat rape, because I've been around long enough that I've seen the whole history from the 80s. And I also wanted to point out, as Elizabeth Armstrong does in her research, that the very thing that's offered up to college students is fun, the party scene, in which women wear skimpy clothing, in which they're often younger than men and expected to be polite even when somebody's verbally or physically out of line, in which boys often control the turf, the alcohol, the transportation, in which alcohol is, you know, I mentioned earlier that in the hookup culture, alcohol doesn't just lubricate, it's, hookup culture is dependent on alcohol to create what Lisa Wade at Occidental calls compulsory carelessness. And the more drunkenness actually, you know, replaces mutual attraction as a reason to have had sex in the morning after recap. Not like I was attracted to him, but I was drunk, so I had sex. And 89% of college students get drunk before a random hookup, averaging 4 or more drinks each time. 3/4 get drunk before hooking up with an acquaintance. And they're most likely to be the most drunk when an encounter includes some form of penetration, and they're most likely to regret those experiences. So again, sorry, that was earlier, but going back into this, alcohol looses inhibitions, it anesthetizes against accountability, and it also undermines the ability to resist. So that party hookup culture can be easily manipulated by some to at best excuse coercion and at worst facilitate assault. And so about 1/4 of the girls that I talked to had been assaulted. And those stories were hard to hear. But fully half of them had experienced some form of pretty extreme coercion in addition to that. And I felt listening to them that the way the media portrays sex and the way we allow kids to learn about sex actually makes coercion an expected part of their interactions. So I wanted to start this conversation because if we don't, they're going to get their information from porn and from the mainstream media that's influenced heavily by porn, and female sexuality that's constructed as a performance for men with distorted bodies. And I also believe in the power of words to make change, or I wouldn't write. And I think about it like the food movement, you know, because I'm from Berkeley, so I think of everything like the food movement. But within 15 years ago, if I'd come in here and said something about free-range chickens, you wouldn't have known what I was talking about. You know, if I talked about factory farming, you would just look blankly at me. But now, because of books by, I know Michael Pollan's here this year, by Michael Pollan and Eric Schlosser and others, you know, we all know what free-range chicken is, right? We all know it. And not everybody, not everywhere has made change, but there's been substantive change on social food justice and on sustainability, not only in alternative culture, but in mainstream culture as well. And those conversations started from books. So my hope is to get this conversation going. And I also looked at other countries. And one of the things that I looked at quite a bit was Holland. And I looked at Amy Shallett's work on that and others. And when you look at comparisons of college women in Holland and college women in America talking about early sexual experiences, the Dutch embody everything we want for our girls. They have fewer negative consequences like regret, pregnancy, disease, more positive consequences like knowing your partner very well, being able to communicate with your partner about your wants, enjoying the experience, preparing for the experience, positive body image, all those things, everything we want. And the big difference is that doctors, teachers, and parents talk to Dutch kids about sex from an early age, explicitly and frankly. And particularly where parents are concerned, American parents are not more less comfortable necessarily talking about sex, but we tend to talk about sex to our kids only in terms of risk and danger. And the Dutch talk about balancing responsibility and joy. And I'll tell you that as a parent, that hit me really hard, because I think had I not delved into that research, I would have talked to my daughter about contraception, disease protection, and because I'm very modern, I would have talked to her about consent, and I would have thought, job well done. And now I know that that is really not enough, and that we have to challenge that. And finally, I end in the book in a classroom with Karis Dennison, who's an educator in Northern California, where boys and girls are working out these issues together, because obviously boys are a huge part of this conversation. And the class is not even so much about sex, though it is about sex. It's about decision-making, assertiveness, developing personal values, respect. And at one point, one of the young men raises his hand, and he says, they've been having this long conversation, he says, hey, I just thought of something. You know that baseball metaphor for sex? In baseball, there's winners and there's losers. So who's the loser supposed to be in sex? Actually, I think the girls are not even a team. I think they're the field, if you think about it. But at any rate, it was this moment for me that was so profound, because I thought, you know, it was just a little thing. But it was a little thing that shifted that boy's perspective. And so from now on, you know, whether his relationships last 10 minutes or the rest of his life, he will go in more as a partner and less as an adversary who thinks of girls' limits as a challenge for him to get over. So I know what I hope for now for girls. I want sexuality to be a source of self-knowledge and creativity and communication, despite its potential risks. I want them to revel in their body's sensuality without being reduced to it. I want them to be able to ask for what they want in bed and to get it. I want them to be safe from disease, unwanted pregnancy, cruelty, dehumanization, violence. If they are assaulted, I want them to have recourse from school administrators, employers, the courts. And it's a lot to ask for, but I think it's not too much. Because as teachers and parents, as activists and advocates, we've encouraged our girls in this generation to have a strong voice, to expect egalitarian treatment in the home, in the classroom, in the workplace. Now I think it's time to demand that intimate justice in their personal lives as well. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Wonderful. And what a wonderful note to end on, intimate justice, a term I...
Isn't that great?
It really is. It really is.
I wish I'd made it up.
I didn't. We prize that honesty here. So, Rick and Justine, are the issues that Peggy raises concerns about, the disregard of female pleasure, sexual harassment, and misogyny, the harm caused by porn and others, are those currently addressed in sex education or in place in school?
Sure. I think it is present in some schools. I'm lucky to be at a school that very much promotes that kind of progressive social justice health education, but the majority of schools in the US definitely do not address this. And I think one reason that this might be the case is when it comes to health education, unlike history, math, science, and social studies, there's a way to assess achievements. There are numbers. There's a quantitative aspect to it. Now, with health education, it's very much preventative. And you know that you have achieved something if nothing has happened. There is no unplanned pregnancies. There's no STIs. There isn't assaults. And so it's hard to back something that you can't put a number to when that is what determines the funding of the school, or that determines what kind of college you might get into, or what your SAT score might be. And so that's always been a huge problem with supporting health education, because there aren't numbers that are as concrete to be able to show that it's effective.
Let me just follow up on that. How did you then start the program at Dalton?
Sure. So after I received my master's degrees in education and public health, I was looking for opportunities in school-based health care. And this opportunity came up, which was not a school-based health clinic, but was an opportunity to build a health program that didn't exist prior. And so it was a really great founding program that was in a school that really allowed me to build as left and as progressive of a health education model as I'd wanted to. And so the school has just known that it's been something lacking for, you know, the whole entire history of it being around. And they didn't want to wait anymore until something bad happened to then finally mobilize community to get a health educator or to bring in more psychologists. This should be something already embedded into the curriculum, institutionalized. But it was really actually my experience with Teach for America, where I had my institute in Houston, and I had a classroom of 24 students, and four of them were already pregnant, two of them were already parents, and this was an eighth grade math classroom. Mm-hmm. And in this environment, I saw, well, I'm in Texas, and abstinence only is what is allowed here, and only that. But it's no wonder they can't do their math homework, because they are taking care of their two-year-old, and they are 16 years old and have failed eighth grade three times. And it's no wonder they can't focus, because they are having, you know, morning sickness, and they are dealing with systemic health issues that are really a part of the achievement gap that we don't think about. So the health disparity is so much in line with also the education disparity. And so that's when I decided I can't do my job as an academic teacher if we don't even address the health education aspects. And so that's what got me down to this path of working in health and in education together.
Thank you so much. Rick, in addition to those concerns that I raised earlier from Peggy's talk, is sexual harassment actually discussed? What are the challenges, and do students have basic information about consent?
Just to step back on sex education, actually a step back even further, this is an absolutely terrific book that everybody should read. It sparked a critical conversation, and I hope it's just the beginning of a conversation, that we really sustain attention on this issue. I totally agree with Justine about the dismal state of sex ed in this country. I mean, it is either abstinence only or it is disaster prevention. It's how not to get pregnant, how not to get STDs. It is often 2 weeks within a six-week health or wellness course. We wildly under-support and under-train the people who are teaching sex ed, and we've entrusted folks who, with almost no training or support, to do one of the most profound and complex tasks there is, which is to teach people about intimacy and sexuality. And we don't have the Ed School or at Harvard a course on sex ed. I mean, we really need to elevate the importance and the status of this profession. So I just wanted to say that about sex ed in general. There is very little talk about sexual harassment. I think if you were to go to most schools in this country, students would not know who they should talk to, whether they had a confidential person to talk to if they were sexually harassed. I think teachers aren't equipped to deal with common forms of sexual harassment that are under their noses or that in their earshot every day, boys saying things, using words like, boys or girls, using words like bitch, slut, or hoe, or phrases like I hit that, and you know, all the phrases for sex seem to be unnervingly violent these days. So we have a real problem, and there's been a kind of deafening silence about this, and this is one of the reasons the book is so important.
Terrific. All three of you, Peggy, you talked about the hookup culture. Is that the main problem? Any of you want to respond to that?
I think it's a symptom. I think the main problem is there's a lack of comprehensive sex education. I think Peggy was really eloquent about showing that this is the outcome of us, you know, seeing that coercion is now the expectation because no one's even talking about it. And I think a problem with the hookup culture is the pressure and that goal-oriented aspect of it. You were speaking to the baseball metaphor. Right. Al Vernacchio is an excellent.
The pizza metaphor.
Yeah, Al Vernacchio.
Do you guys know the pizza metaphor?
Can
I tell them?
Yeah,
you can. I was going to put that in, but I figured you probably all knew it already. Al Vernacchio, who's this fabulous educator in Pennsylvania, advocates replacing the baseball metaphor with the pizza metaphor, because if you think about it, you know, it's a metaphor that's about a shared experience. You know, you decide together, do you want to go out for a pie? If you do, you negotiate the toppings, and maybe I like mushrooms and you like pepperoni, and we go halvesies, or this time we get mushrooms, next time we get, or if you keep insisting on pepperoni and I keep kosher, I'm not going to go out to pizza with you anymore. You know, I mean, you can just like stretch it a lot of ways. But one thing that somebody said to me the other day about this metaphor, which was interesting, was that for so many young women, for so many girls, they have a fallback of whatever you want. Like if you say, what movie do you want to go to tonight? I don't know, whatever you want. You know, what restaurant do you want to go to? Whatever you want. So you have to actually, with the pizza metaphor, you have to care what's on your pizza. You know, you just have to care what toppings are going to go on your pizza. So it encompasses some of that as well.
Yeah. I'll add to the aspects of the pizza metaphor that are so brilliant about it is, when are you expected to play baseball? When it's baseball season, a.k.a. prom night, a.k.a. when parents aren't home. There's an expectation when those environments are in place. But when do you have pizza? When you are hungry for it. You have a hunger for it, which makes sense for what it should be with sex as well. Now, when does the game or the baseball end? When the game is over. Or in other words, for some, they call when the money shot, when he finishes. Mm-hmm. When do you stop eating pizza? When you are full, when you are satiated. That might be one slice, it might be 10. It might be, actually, I'm feeling like a salad today. Mm-hmm. So I think that's what's really great about that negotiation, because that is exactly what sex should be like as well. Not just asking, you know, what do you want today, but also how much do you even want it? And that is when the pleasure perspective and that sex positivity becomes a part of play, whereas this goal-oriented aspect with the hookup culture is so how many times did you get laid? Did you hit that? Mm-hmm. I'll just do whatever you want. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, takes out the agency to what sexuality is really all about.
Mm-hmm. Rick?
So I think, without question, hookup culture is a problem, but I think that people have wildly exaggerated the extent of the hookup culture, and that's a problem in itself. Mm-hmm. And Peggy has written about this, that, you know, it looks like young people today are having less sex than we were, or whoever
more
we
sex,
were.
You mean?
I mean,
it's
less
sex. It looks like they're having more sex. No? It looks like they're having less sex?
Yes, less sex than we were.
They are.
30
mm-hmm.
years. Yeah, yeah. They are having less sex. Oh,
so I said it looked like
sorry.
They are. You are.
You
me.
Are. Yeah, whoever you are. Yeah, no, sorry, we got the we's and the you's confused there.
Just got a little confused there.
But on average, they are hooking up about 2.5 times a year. I don't know what mm-hmm. a half a hookup is. But
just a tip.
But, you know, there are about 15% of young people who are hooking up, and hooking up ranges from everything from making out to intercourse, yeah. So it's this wide range of things. And there are about 15% of young people who are hooking up more than 4 or 5 times a year. That means that 85% are not. And, you know, in our surveys, in our research, one of the things that we see is that 85% are looking for basic information mm-hmm. like that we've all been looking for. They're just anxious. How do you start a relationship? How do you maintain a relationship? How do you learn how to break up with somebody in a way that's caring and respectful? I mean, there's a whole conversation about relationships that's very important. And the damage in the myth of the hookup culture is that so many people feel like they're defective because they're not mm-hmm. hooking up. Mm-hmm. And Peggy and I were talking about this at lunch. You worry about the pressure to hook up because of the perception that so many people are doing it, it's the mm-hmm. norm. And because people can feel so deficient. So I think this is like a myth that we have to take on very yeah. forcefully.
It's a feedback loop.
It's a feedback loop. And mm-hmm. just to be clarified, and there are 15% of kids who are getting hammered and hooking up and engaging in coercive sex. It's really concerning, and I'm not diminishing that. But in a way, we're having a conversation. Isn't that relevant to 85% of the kids out there? Mm-hmm.
It was also interesting. I talk about going into a class at IU with Debbie Herbenick, who's at the Kinsey Institute on human sex, and the class was on human sexuality, and she polled about 120 students in the class and said, you know, what do you think that your peers want a hookup or a relationship more? And they said, oh, they all, you know, 80% of them said hookup. And they said, what do you want more?
Yeah.
And it flipped. 80% said they would prefer to have a relationship.
Yeah,
a loving, caring relationship, to have sex in the context of loving.
Yeah, yeah, there's other data. I mean, so I've asked this question to thousands of people about every age group. And it's interesting because young people are often the most off in their answers. And, you know, you ask young people the question, and I think Michael Kimmel has done this, you know, what percentage of students on campus are hooking up on a weekend? They'll say about 80%. The real number is about 15%. Mm-hmm. So, again, there's this misalignment between the perception and the reality.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, what are the key messages that teen girls should be hearing from educators and parents about sexuality?
I think, Deb, the most important, the way to, actually I would revise that question would be when these messages should be sent.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think the what we can get into for sure, but I think the bigger problem is that they wait until something wrong has happened or until they hit puberty or something is in the news and then they have to, you know, put a fire out because how are they going to explain this to their kids because it's already on the news. It should really be starting as soon as they get out of the womb.
Mm-hmm.
Already you are a sexual being because you came out of a genital and that needs to be addressed. But I mean, just with basic language, normalizing the anatomical terms for, you know, what our body parts look like. You know, like when you're bathing your child, you're asking them, okay, point to your nose, where's your ear, where's your pee-pee, or where's your hoo-ha, and they cover it up. And all, you know, kids are learning right away that there must be something wrong if it's said quieter, or there's another word for it. So by the time it actually becomes something they need to use, they're now afraid to use it. So that stigma starts at such an early age.
Mm-hmm.
And I think already talking about consent as a toddler, when you know a family member comes over and they start tickling the toddler and the kid is laughing but saying stop, stop, or no, no, what does that family member tend to do? They keep going with that. You are now completely invalidating the word stop and no. But then they might justify it and say, well, because they're an adult, so that makes it okay then. Or if I now can go ahead and tickle so-and-so on my play date, then I'm gonna keep doing it even if they're saying no. And often I hear, well, they're laughing, they're smiling. That's victim blaming. It's the same thing. Well, look what they were wearing. Well, they were drinking. It's the same thing when you add 18 years to that equation, and that's the same argument that we're talking about in college campuses.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, respecting that. And if the person really means yes, but they are saying no, but they really do want that, they will eventually give a real yes at some point. So if that toddler does want grandma to be tickling them, but they keep saying no, grandma needs to take hands off and respect that. Because if the child really wants it, they'll say, do it again, which is enthusiastic consent, which is really what we want to be the new baseline for what consent is, and not no means no. One, that's sex negative, and two, it doesn't address silence. It doesn't address sure, okay, or I guess, which mm-hmm. is affirmation, but not enthusiastic
right.
affirmation. And with a sex positive, you know, pleasure mindset to that, if our baseline of consent is enthusiastic, it's a yes with an exclamation point, it's a hell yes, it's an expletive here with a yes, then one, it's not only assurance that that person wants to be doing that with you, but two, it's gonna feel better because that's affirmation that that person wants to be doing that intimate act with you. And that's intimacy justice.
Right. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I totally agree that teaching kids about sexuality is a lifelong thing that often isn't really about sexuality.
Right.
It's about decency, how we treat other people, bodily integrity, all these other kinds of messages that we send. And, you know, it puzzles me in that way why it is such a source of anxiety and fear, because I think that if we do start talking about it young, when we can start talking about it young, then it becomes easier. And you want to be that person that your child can go to. I mean, that's what you're trying to build towards, is being that person that your child can go to. And one of the things in the Dutch research that really affected me, again, was this idea that in America, we expect teenagers to mature into adults by creating a rift with the family. And by essentially lying about what they're doing. And it's particularly difficult for girls. Amy Shallott talks about this, because they have to be the good girl at home and put on this front, which is completely different than who they're being in the world. And in Holland, they're expected to grow up interdependently with the family and discuss all these issues in a word that I said earlier I cannot pronounce, but sounds kind of like but it means cozy togetherness. And all these things are discussed, she gives an example of after a girl has her first intercourse, she comes home and tells her mom and her mom's friends, and they say, oh, did you have fun? Did you have an orgasm? Did he have an orgasm? What was it like? And I thought, you know, I don't want my child to have to grow up by disconnecting from me,
right,
you know, as a parent. And that really made a huge difference in how I thought about and studied and came to terms with these issues for myself as a mom. Mm-hmm.
I'm going to start with you this time, Rick, and we're going to go to Q&A in a minute. But I wanted to have you talk about how we bring LGBTQ teens into this discussion, as well as boys. But let's first go to LGBTQ.
Well, I'd love to hear what both of these folks have to say about this. But again, you know, as a country, we have come, I think, a very long way around LGBTQIA issues, and it's changing so rapidly. I'm learning a ton from my students about this, and I think older adults really have a lot to learn about younger adults about these issues of gender orientation and sexuality, and fluidity. Mm-hmm. And how people think about that. I think in schools and educators, most educators don't have knowledge or information about how to engage students. Jennifer Bryan does a lot of work with LGBTQIA students that I think is very important. I also think we have the same issue, which is these kids are more likely to be bullied, they're more likely to be harassed, and educators, again, don't have the tools to know how to deal with that. Even things like That's So Gay, which is so common. I mean, it's just ricocheting off the hallways in schools. And, you know, as an educator, you know, often what happens is either you don't intervene or you do intervene and a kid says, I'm being ironic or I'm being funny. And then you're kind of stuck because you don't know how to respond to that. And there is a response. You know, we have to give people tools for responding to that. But, you know, these are the kind of things we got to do role plays about with educators and kids. We just got to become much wiser about a range of contexts in which we're constantly interacting with kids around these issues.
When we were inside and we had a little bit of this conversation, we were pointing out that if someone made a racist remark, someone made a religious intolerant remark, we as educators would find the words to speak up.
Yeah.
And I think that we have to find the words to speak up when somebody says something ignorant like that's so gay.
Yeah.
It's not optional to speak up.
Let me say something about boys quickly.
Sure.
Yeah, and I would love to hear these Justine and Peggy's thoughts about boys as well, because I think it's super important for women to be able to talk to boys and for men to be able to talk to girls about these issues in educational settings and at home. What I wanted just to say about boys is two things. One is I think part of what we're dealing here with is the narcissism of male desire, that men think that what's pleasurable to them is pleasurable to women and to girls. And porn reinforces that concept over and over and over again. So at minimally, we have to talk to men about the nature of women's pleasure, how it can be different from their pleasure, how to give women pleasure. Seems super important to me. The other thing I was going to say, and many of you may disagree with me about this, but I think sometimes we're having a conversation with men that isn't really connecting with them, because we're talking to boys and men about words like empathy and listening. And for many boys and men, those are feminizing words. And I'm not saying they should be, but they are. And I do training with the National Guard, and I'm very aware of this. And instead, the kind of language that I find myself using is much more about, you know, if you want to do something really tough and courageous, figure out how to love somebody else. I mean, that's a really hard thing to do. Figure out how to have the courage-focused discipline you need to have an intimate relationship. Be an upstander. Stand up to somebody who is degrading women. But I think we're going to get farther with the language of honor and courage than we are with the language of empathy and listening.
Mm. What, Justine and
Peggy? Sure. I'll speak to the boys part first, since that's the freshest in my mind right now. I think the issue with when we do sex ed with boys, it tends to be all the more fear-based and disease-oriented and harm reduction in that sense, or telling them, hey, boys, don't rape, and, you know, leaves them out of the equation for talking about intimacy. And I think as a society, we also don't value what we feminize. And that is a problem because that makes a statement about what we think about feminine people and or what we think about women. And so I think if we can reframe our thinking on what feminization can be and how great it can be for someone of any gender, that would be a great first step to getting boys to start to embrace that aspect of their identities, because they do have estrogen in their body, but they aren't allowed to maybe exercise it. It's frowned upon. And I think it's important to emphasize, you know, the emotional aspect of it, because, you know, we see some really stark statistics when it comes to how boys then do get their emotions out. They're only allowed to feel anger, but they aren't allowed to be sad. And how do they get that anger out when they're so repressed from sadness? Violence. And then violence means social capital. And we're really starting to, you know, put masculinity in a very narrow definition as well, instead of including femininity as something that they are allowed to embrace as, also.
So just very quickly on this, I know that we have to open it up. I think Justine and I probably want to get to exactly the same point, but I think the conversation about femininity is very far from where so many men are right now, that you have to start at a different place. So that's the distinction, I think.
Well, and LGBT as well as queer as well as boys, if you would.
all of that.
Well, I mentioned, as I said when I spoke, that I think that bisexual and lesbian girls do have a great deal to teach us about straight girls. But, you know, again, I think that it's just that bisexuality, homosexuality, asexuality, gender differences in identity can be addressed all along the way. There's just no reason really not to. And with boys, I'm going to go back to the Dutch yet again, because another thing that struck me was that when Amy Shallett compared Dutch and American boys, American boys would say to her that they wanted love, but that they considered that to be a personal quirk. And Dutch boys would say, these are high school kids, Dutch boys would say, of course I want to be in love with my partner. Why wouldn't you want to be in love with your partner? So there's another way that discussion about expectation, about ethics, about responsibility, about mutuality, about all of that was, and what the boys would say in Holland was, my father taught me that. Mm. That was the other key piece. So there is a way that kids are, if we don't speak to them, you know, again, if we don't speak to them, we're going to let the media do our educating for us, and that just doesn't turn out very well for anybody.
No, it doesn't.
Two fun facts about Dutch that I wanted to add to what Peggy was saying is that when it comes to sleepovers for adolescents, they allow their children to sleep over at their partner's home, and the parents are there, the parents are the ones giving them condoms. And yet when we look at, you know, sexual initiation, age of sexual initiation, they actually have sex earlier on average than American teens at 16, whereas in the US it's 17, but they have the lowest numbers in unplanned pregnancies, the lowest numbers of STI, because they're having those conversations at home and it's normalized from the get-go. Mm-hmm.
We have a long way to go. On that note, I'm going to invite people who are able to ask succinct questions to please come to the mic. There's one on this side and one in the center there, and our panelists look forward to your queries. Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Deb.
Please.
Me?
Yes.
Just you. So my question is about porn. I'm an educational psychologist. I talk to a lot of parents about their concerns about online porn, and I've worked in a lot of schools where it's a big issue. And I look at what some other countries are doing to take steps towards reducing kids' access to porn. And here, when you talk about it, I think the only thing more threatening to men that you would take away is guns than porn. But there's such a visceral reaction against any kind of censorship of free speech and that kind of thing. But I want to know what your opinion is on how we deal with this going forward, because I know you sound like such a prude when you talk about this, but it is so damaging to kids. The labiaplasty, all the stuff that you're talking about is all coming straight from porn. And is this something as a country that you think we can actually do something about, or is it something we have to live with and parents have to learn to explain to their kids?
What are they doing in other countries? I don't know what they're doing in other countries.
In England, they have someone whose job, they're some kind of minister, I guess, in England, who is doing something about reducing access and actually through the internet. Can you explain that? I mean, because I don't have a clear idea about
it. I know just what you know, too. They've developed some ways of restricting access on the internet, and I don't know how successful they've been.
Right, right. So I just don't know whether the answer is to try to actually do something about porn and its availability to kids, or are we as parents just left having to say, it's just a movie, that's not how it really is, and all the good things that we say as kids, but kids are watching it a lot, and they still get the messages from it that result in all these things. So I just don't know whether you think, what direction you think we should go in as a country.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'll tackle that one first. So I think even if we were to find some effective policy on restricting access, you're still going to get kids that are going to find a way to watch it. It could be a friend getting special access from an older sibling and then still showing it, or it's being video screenshotted in some way. They're still going to have access to it. And so I think the way we need to really address it is by making them porn literate. And this is an actual class that I give in my school to both high school students and to parents in the parent education workshops that I give. So porn literacy 101. And it does include what you were mentioning on, this is not necessarily real, or what do you think this says, what messages are it sending about women and about behaviors, what's normal and bodies and exaggerations and whatnot. But I think the issue with being so fear-based around porn is that you leave out the idea that it can also have a very sex-positive framework to it. Thankfully, this may be a radical statement, because of porn and because of the internet, students are allowed to now access information about what other bodies can do because you have this in film. Now it depends what kind and the quality, of course. Most of it is misogynistic porn, but there is feminist porn that is out there and that is actually informing people in a constructive way, and it's just harder to access those types of porn. Now, when we're looking at kids that are accessing it as young as 8 years old and then not doing anything with it because parents are just too scared to have the conversation, that's when it becomes really, really problematic, because they think, this is what it actually looks like, this is what my body needs to be, this is what I need to be attracted to, this is how I need to look in order to be attractive. And having those conversations around media literacy and porn literacy, I think, are just as critical as, are we talking about the lyrics to Blurred Lines? And any other song out there that is perpetuating rape culture. So I think it's hard to put a restriction that is going to be effective in terms of policy. They'll find a way to still access it. So the best way to still address it is to have those conversations, not just in school and leaving it to sex educators, but those conversations happening at home as well.
Mm-hmm. I know parents are always afraid of how early they're supposed to start having those conversations. But thank you.
Right out the womb.
Yeah. I'd also just say that while I think porn is the explosion in porn has exacerbated a problem, I recently had a conversation with my daughter about porn, and then the next day or a couple days later, we saw the movie Brooklyn, which, totally fine movie, nothing wrong with the movie Brooklyn, right? But it had a very typical sex scene in it, which is the kind of sex scene that kids see, I don't know, approximately, and I'm not kidding when I say this, 30,000 times in their childhood, where the characters kissed. It was totally unremarkable. The characters kissed for 3 seconds, they ripped half their clothes off, they apparently had intercourse for 3 seconds, and then everybody was happy. And we forget that we need to comment on that kind of imagery too. And so, I said to my daughter, honey, you know how like when people take a cab ride in a movie, you see them get into the cab, and then you see them get out of the cab at their destination, but you don't see everything that happens in between. because that would be long and tedious and boring and take up the whole movie. So similarly, there have been a series of images that have been created that are very, you know, from a particular point of view about what sex, you know, what sex is supposed to look like, that they throw up, that's a shorthand to tell you that sex has happened here. But don't confuse that with what sex is. And I think it's really important to disrupt mainstream media message, not just the porn, in our concern about porn, not to forget about mainstream media.
Absolutely.
I'm Kim Marshall, sex educator and former principal. I really hope that your book has the same impact as Pollan's book had on free-range chickens. but how do we get from here to there? I think that's the big question. The thing that just jumped out at me was the contrast between the Dutch mother saying, you know, when you coming back saying, did you have an orgasm? Was it fun? And one of the reviewers of your book or the other book in the New York Times the other day saying that her 14-year-old daughter bolted out of the room every time she talked about this book, and
she might be
in Nebraska
kid.
By now.
Yeah.
I mean, good grief. So what's your logic model in the best possible world where you publish this book, it's getting a lot of attention, how do we get from here to where American parents can talk to their kids like the Dutch parents? What are the steps there?
Well, I'll tell you that from my own perspective in terms of my impact, I feel like, I mean, the book is great, but honestly, I did an interview with Fresh Air that seems to have like blown up and become incredibly popular for just this reason. People are writing me constantly and saying, we listen to your Fresh Air interview in the car, because it's always the car, right? You always want to talk in the car. And I had the best talk with my daughter. I had the best talk with my son. So that I think even more than the book, because people don't read as much as I wish they did, has actually started that conversation, I have to say. So I'm very happy about that. How your average parent gets there, you know, I think they have to want to recognize the need to. Recognize a community need to.
I was going to say something about that. I didn't interrupt you.
No, go ahead.
Kim, we can talk about this another time too. But while we're here, I think we need a public education and a public health campaign about this. I mean, I think it's a very serious problem. It's a more pervasive problem than bullying, and I think parents need some simple messages to use with their kids. We were just talking about pornography, so. You know, it is a fundamental abdication of responsibility when boys are saturating themselves with porn and learning about sexuality that way, and parents aren't discussing it. Think about all the things that we hear on the radio with our kids all the time that are just openly and grossly misogynist, and parents aren't talking about it.
You know, the trouble is I think, too, that porn has been put forward as a liberal thing. And I think that that's something to challenge, too, that because I get a lot of emails from people who say, I'm really liberal, but I'm concerned about porn, as if those two things are in contradiction. Whereas I think it's actually a fundamentally conservative thing, because it reinforces ideas of female subjugation and females as existing for male gratification.
The parents I know are all...
But I know that they're all over the map about it.
Well,
but
I think
liberal parents, I think, feel fear or prudery if they... And people do, if they speak out against what's going on with porn in our kids right now. And I think that they have to get over that.
Yeah, they sure do. No, they do. I mean, I just feel like it's, you know, it's gotten to this degree that, you know, it's so important to take on. I just want to tell you a very quick story, and I apologize for my students who have heard this before, but I want to just pick up on something that Peggy said in the book, which is I used to watch Grey's Anatomy with my daughter. And she's probably 16, 15 or 16 years old, and there's a scene in there where Little Gray, I don't know if some of you watch Grey's Anatomy, but Little Gray is talking to, I think it's Mick Steamy, an older man, about 10 years older than her. She's probably 28, he's probably 38. And she says to him, you need to teach me. Like, you need to teach me how to have sex. And I said to my daughter, I just could not bear this. I said to my daughter, you know, you're going to have a lot to teach men about sex and about your body, and it's really important that you do that. And she said to me, you know, Dad, if you ever say anything like that to me again, I will never speak to you. and yet, I am really glad I said it. And I mean it. And I just feel like this is a simple message for parents too. It's not like your kids want to hear these things. There's a scene in Glee with a father talking to his son, which is a wonderful scene too, where he starts it like this is no fun for you, it's no fun for me, but we're gonna do this. And you know, there are times where you just have to do that. You have to just take the plunge. And it's irresponsible not to.
And you send the message that the door is open whenever they are ready.
Yeah.
And I also, you know, sometimes I think you have to build a team for your child too. Mm-hmm. And if you really can't do that, then, I mean, I know that I've been that person for friends' kids, and I remember going out with a friend's daughter who was 16 at the time and was thinking about having intercourse with her boyfriend, and I said, we were just talking about this, I said, look, you know, we talked about safety, we talked about disease, all that kind of stuff. And then I said, I just want to ask you some questions. You don't have to answer them, but I just want to throw them out there. Have you had an orgasm on your own? Have you had an orgasm with your partner? Can you tell your partner what you want, what you like, what you don't like, your limits, and have those all heard and respected? If you're answering no to those questions, what exactly do you want out of intercourse? Why are you pursuing this? What is it that you hope for? And honestly, I don't know what she decided at that point, but she's 24 now, and we talk, you know, just about weekly, and we talk about her, you know, her sex life, we talk about her applications to graduate. I was just asking about her for you about her, for her, and all these things, and I feel like it was that moment that I did that said, I'm here, I stand here for you, you can say anything to me, the door is always open, and there will be no judgment, and you know, we all need that. So if you can't be that person because you're too anxious or embarrassed, it would be good if you could be that person and get over it. But if you can't, find somebody who can.
We have quite a few people and just a little bit of time. So we're going to go here and we'll go back and forth. Yes. Thank you.
In this school of education, where are teachers allowed in schools to talk with kids in sex positive ways? And how can we make that happen?
No, thank you so much for such a succinct, beautiful question. That is the prototype. Okay, one of you respond.
Well, you School of Education. Yeah.
Well, I don't know if either of you have thoughts about what schools of education should be doing, or Deborah, whether you have thoughts about what the schools are.
I think if you're able to convince any school, private or public, that sex positive and a pleasure-based lens of sexuality will actually increase the exercising of scrutiny for who those partners you would allow to be intimate with you, which would maybe delay sexual initiation or less multiple partners, whatever language they think that makes us promiscuous as children, you'll be able to have sex positive education. Mm-hmm. They wanna see numbers decrease to make a point that it's gonna be effective. We wanna see lower unplanned pregnancies, we wanna see lower STI rates, we wanna see healthy relationships. All of that can be addressed with sex positive education with a pleasure perspective. And I think people don't give enough credit to talking about pleasure in schools because they're scared of it, or it's against, you know, or it's very stigmatized. But if pleasure is your foundation, then you're not gonna have anyone else be a part of that intimate experience if you don't know pleasure yourself, or they don't know how to give you pleasure. And I think exercising that level of scrutiny is not something that we are even giving kids right now the luxury of exercising, because we're just telling them don't rape and don't get, you know, pregnant or don't get an STI. And the famous scene in Mean Girls with the gym teacher saying don't get pregnant or get an STI because then you'll die. Here are some rubbers. Of the fact that people need to be able to please them. And that's a big ask. And that would actually make them a little bit more literate with their body and who enters that body.
Hi, great panel. I wanted to ask a question to Justine, who actually we know each other from New York. We taught the Our Whole Lives program together. And to Peggy. One, Justine, I'd love to hear about the Dalton School and a little bit about the curriculum and what's there. And to Peggy, I was curious if you're in your interviews, I have not read your books yet, because I certainly will, if you could see differences in folks who had received comprehensive sex ed either through school or non-school-based settings, and if that came out, like if they mentioned like a teen health center. I'm gonna make a plug. I work for Cambridge Health Alliance. We have a sexual reproductive health department. We run teen health centers and also do counseling and related primary care clinics. So anyways, I'd love to hear your thoughts on that. Thanks.
Thank you.
So at the school that I work at, they didn't have any kind of coordinated health program up until 4 years ago. And so they tasked me with being the director of health and wellness starting in the fourth grade. If I had it my way and my job title included kindergarten through 12th grade, then we would be starting in kindergarten. Because yes, sex ed can start in kindergarten, right out the womb. And so in the fourth grade, we start with lessons about gender identity, the spectrum of gender expression, femininity, biological sex, and then we have lessons around pre-puberty and just how you're dealing with those emotional, the emotional state that you may get to based on how your body is changing in such a drastic way and what happens in each of those stages. So that happens over a course of a few lessons. In the fifth grade, we do a lot more lessons on reproductive biology since time-wise and development-wise, this is when their bodies are actually going through that. So it's a lot more reproductive biology, and I partner and collaborate with our science department since they also have an additional unit on love, sex, and reproduction. And so we make sure our curriculums are in line with one another. And then the consent lessons start in actually the fourth grade with just safety and ownership over your own body. And when you're going to a doctor, a good doctor is first going to ask before they check your breathing with a stethoscope, you know, between your shirt and your skin, are you comfortable if I do this? Or I am now going to check your breathing. And if they don't ask for permission, then that's already a first time that you can start to assert yourself. Can you please ask for my permission first? Or is it okay if my parent is present for this exam? Or I'm kind of uncomfortable, can you wait a second? And so this conversation can start already in fourth grade, and it does. In the sixth grade, it's a lot more about consent when it comes to relationships, since they start to have partnerships at that point, or it becomes a little bit more popular with flirting versus hurting, and what those signs look like, and how your intentions might be good, but the outcome might not be. And so how do you start negotiating and navigating through some of those challenges? There's a little bit more reproductive biology, since it's definitely still relevant. And more specifically, lessons about just consent and what that looks like with borrowing a friend's phone and just, you know, giving, you know, your passcode like it's no big deal because that's your best friend and because you gave it to them once, it means it's always okay. Same kind of metaphor for just because you said yes to sex once, it doesn't mean you're always down for it. What if you feel like having salad that day and not pizza that day? In the seventh grade, and we do a lot more body image and how that starts to impact your ideas of owning your sexuality. Eighth grade is a lot more healthy relationships, contraception, what are STIs, gender identity, more body image. And in the high school, I teach in the 10th and 12th grade, and we'll have lessons around porn literacy, a lot of media literacy. We study a lot of song lyrics and music videos and what the implications are and how to interpret those. Decision making with a lot of vignettes and scenarios and kind of what would you do. There's some role play, communication skills, a self-worth and defining love. I think that they come hand in hand. If you know how to love yourself, you might be able to understand love for another a little bit better. And then birth control and other kinds of protective devices. So in the health, in the sexuality, sex ed part, that's what it looks like at my school. But there's also a component for the parents. They get a lot of education as well around these topics, and the faculty get professional development. It was very important to me that the three main branches of a school were getting all the same information so that the conversation goes beyond the health classroom, at home, on car rides, with their history teacher, because I might not be the faculty member they feel comfortable talking about a personal issue to. It might be their science teacher. Mm-hmm. So they also need to be well equipped.
That's great. It sounds a lot like the Our Whole Lives curriculum embedded in school. So I'm an alum of HGSE, and I wrote my dissertation here on the psychological meaning of the first experience of intercourse. And I interviewed young men and women and freshmen in college. And the conversation is so similar from 40 years ago when I did this. Or did the math 35 years ago. The question that I have is, what at that point I was trying to look at the forces that the young people were kind of under, and porn really hadn't hit. So the fact that there's still a lot of similarities of confusion around relationship building and communication and all those issues, which we were trying to get at earlier, is very powerful. What I'm wondering is, what forces other than porn and the internet do we think are particularly impactful and the age group of the young people who are now admittedly either not or having the experiences or not. I mean, when I did my work, it was about counting the number of virgins that were left. I mean, there was a lot of focus on numbers, and I was really interested in the quality of the experience and people's addressing it. So are there forces other than porn and the internet that you think are particularly relevant and powerful now that we should also be helping our young people understand, you know, kind of the maelstrom that they're in while they're trying to connect with each other?
Thank you.
Well, I think all the forces that have been there are still there, basically. So all the ones that you knew about back then, you know, the stigma around, there's a I'm forgetting the name of, Laura Carpenter wrote a really interesting book on virginity and on how kids, boys and girls, relate to virginity as defined by first intercourse, and came up with sort of four different ways that kids relate to it. One was as a gift, a special gift that you give to a special partner, and each had its strengths and weaknesses in terms of what then the outcome of that was. One was as a stigma to just like get rid of as quickly as possible. One was the healthiest attitude was as a process, as part of a process of sexual self-discovery. And then the fourth was being a virgin for God. So when, you know, what I always think about, we were talking about this a little bit earlier, you know, what happened, how did, I really feel on a certain level that as a feminist mom who is an our bodies ourselves baby, that somehow we dropped the ball. You know, I don't know what we did, but we didn't keep it going. And I think so much has changed for young women. You know, we've made progress in so many realms, in education, in leadership, in sports, in professional life, in domestic life, and yet not in this one area. And it's almost bizarre to me that we've just let this one area be blacked out and silenced, and you know, and it hasn't. There's been things that have been hanging around here since you did that research that still need to change.
Just to say one thing about this, I mean, this is a great question. I think this is a puzzle with many pieces, but you know, one of the paradoxes is that the more girls are accelerating in school, the more they're outnumbering men in college, the more they're accelerating the workplace. It looks like, and there's big differences across race, culture, and class here that we really haven't talked about, but it looks like for a lot of women and girls, they're becoming, the more they advance, the more subordinate they're becoming in their sexual relationships. And those two things may be related. I mean, it's partly on college campuses, there is a phenomena of women outnumbering men and men dictating the terms of relationship in ways that they were not able to dictate the terms of relationship in earlier times. I think there are a lot of boys, men who are threatened by women's progress in these different settings and are asserting their power in their sexual relationships. So I think these are other pieces of the puzzle.
I'd add social media is the newest one that hasn't been there before. It makes it seem like there is more of that experience when it might be not the case, but that perception ends up becoming reality. And the notion that, you know, everyone's drinking and everyone's hooking up when that might not actually be the case.
Mm-hmm. In the FOMO phenomenon.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So
you are on fleek.
I am really sorry to those three wonderful people who have stood there so patiently, but I know that the panel will stay and answer, you know, have a conversation with you first. So that your questions can be addressed, because we have hit the magic hour. And I would ask you all to join me in thanking Peggy, Rick, and Justine for...
Thank you, Deborah.
It's been informative and just inspiring. To know that this work is being done in school so it can be replicated. I know about Rick's research, and I will read your book. I think I want to start with Cinderella, though.
Okay.
Because I definitely was raised with the pink, and so I'm interested in that. Let me share with all of you that Peggy will be signing her book right outside in Askwith Hallway, and so many of us have said that we wanted to read it, those of us who haven't, so you can not only get the book, but with her signature, and perhaps a piece of advice goes with that, I don't know. And then you are invited to attend the last Askwith Forum of the semester. It'll take place this Thursday, and it's called When Facebook and Summit Public Schools Meet, Collaborate, whatever. Engineering, okay, thank you. And there'll be a reception following that forum. So once again, thank you all. You were fabulous. Thanks to our students. Would that committee stand? The whole committee. Really great, thank you. And please come up. Come on up, and you have the first dibs. You can go. Okay.